From Luke's Gospel, the 15th chapter. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus, but the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." And then Jesus told them this parable. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. And then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep." I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. Or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Doesn't she light a lamp, sweep the house clean, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost coin." In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. You know, very often I find myself thinking about heaven, and I love the words of Scripture, and I like sharing them from Revelation chapter 21 as it describes heaven as a place where there will be no more weeping, no more sadness, no more crying, no more pain. And I start thinking about heaven and how blissful it will be, and I start thinking about what's in it for me. And I look forward to heaven, but this passage of Scripture reminds me that heaven is not so much for us. It is for us, but it is also for God. It's a place of rejoicing. What makes God happy is not so much that we have our tickets punched, that our names have been written in the Lamb's Book of Life. What makes God happy, as it says in this passage of Scripture, is when one sinner repents. When our names are written in the book of life, when the roll is called up yonder, we will be there, but we will be there surrounding the throne, worshiping God. It will be less about what's in it for us and more about how we have made God happy. So how do we make God happy? Well, we might want to do exactly what this passage of Scripture says. We might want to first be found, and secondly, we might want to tell others and invite them to come to the party because we've been found. There's a fellow who's written a book. I love the title of it. His name is Ken Davis. The title of his book is, "I Don't Remember Dropping the Skunk, But I Remember Trying to Breathe." I don't remember dropping the skunk, but I do remember trying to breathe. He tells about an experience that he had as a newlywed with his wife, Diane. He saw one morning, not long after they were married, her wedding ring on the edge of the sink. He thought to himself, "Well, that's careless." And he thought, "Well, maybe I'll play a little trick on her. I'll have some fun with this." And so he takes the ring and he puts it away in a drawer. Diane spends the rest of the day looking on the edge of the couch, lifting up things and looking underneath. And she was looking fretfully. And Ken would say to her, "What are you doing?" And she didn't want to admit it, so she would say, "Oh, nothing, I'm just trying to find something, just trying to find something." And then she would go on and on during the day trying to find that special ring, that special something that represented their love for one another. And then they went to bed. Ken had pretty much placed it in the back of his mind. He thought, "Well, maybe I'll tell her about it tomorrow." And little did he know that during the night, her sobbing uncontrollably shook the bed, woke him up, and he said, "What's the matter?" And sobbing, she said, "I've lost my wedding ring." He said, "Oh, that's no big deal. I know exactly where it is." And she growled, "What?" And then he said to her, I took your ring as a joke. I know just where it is, so you can go to sleep. And Ken Davis then writes, it was dark, so I didn't see her fist coming, but I did feel it land. In 25 years of marriage, that was the only time she's ever hit me. It was also the last time I ever took her ring. You know, God is in the business of finding the things that are lost. Some of us have paused and prayed when we've misplaced our rings or our car keys or our wallets, and we've wondered where they are. Some of us have prayed the prayer of St. Anthony, and we've done it in the vernacular way. Tony, Tony, look around. Something is lost and it cannot be found. And others of us have prayed more properly the prayer of St. Anthony, who is the patron saint of finding lost things. St. Anthony, please come around. Something is lost and it cannot be found. Whether we go searching and looking or pausing and praying or even pray the prayer of St. Anthony, we've all lost things. We've all lost things. But God is a God who likes to look for lost things. God is a God who leaves the 99. And we've often thought that how ridiculous it would be to leave the 99 sheep out in open country and go searching for that lost sheep. It doesn't make much good sense. But on the other hand, if you know anything about sheep, you know they're herders. They like to stick together for the most part. Now, every now and then, there's that one or two that might nibble their way into the far country. But for the most part, leaving 99 together in the open country is the safest place they can be. But he goes to search for the one that's lost. Or when it comes to the part of this parable, these parables that Jesus is telling in front of these Pharisees and these teachers of the law who think that he's been welcoming sinners, he tells about the woman who's lost her coin. Now, she's got 9 other coins, so what's the big deal? But most of us don't know that in Bible times, when someone got married, the woman did not receive a wedding ring for her finger, but she received a circlet of 10 coins to either wear around her head or to wear as a necklace around her neck. And if she lost one of those coins, or if one of those coins had been taken away from her by her husband, it meant that their relationship was dissolved, that she had done something wrong, and she really was a woman of ill repute. She was to be shunned. So all the more, it says, she lit a lamp because it was dark in the house. And all the more that she swept the whole closet, the whole house. And we have to remember that the houses of that day didn't have granite tile in them. They were mostly dirt floors, if not some mosaic in a rich person's house. And so she swept her house clean, looking for that dirty coin. In the same way, God goes looking after us, and he wants to find us. He's giving a message, not just to the Pharisees, but he's giving us a message that God is in the business of saving sinners. God is in the business of saving whomever is lost. But in our culture, we don't even want to admit that we are lost. We depend on the GPS and we depend on every other thing. We don't even say we're sorry when we do things wrong. It's those three words that our culture finds it somehow almost impossible to say, I'm sorry. For 44 years, I have been majoring in saying, I am sorry to my dearly beloved. But very often in our culture, among younger generations, I hate to admit it, and every generation for that matter, we find it difficult to say, I am sorry. We'd rather say it was somebody else's fault, or it was the repairman's fault, it was the company's fault, it's planned obsolescence that caused it to break down. We don't say that we did something wrong, and we have a hard time saying, I am sorry. There was a guy at confession who had been stealing lumber, it seems. And so he told the priest on the other side of the screen in the confessional booth that he had been stealing lumber for decades and had been using the lumber to build a house for himself, houses for his children, even homes for his family and friends. And the father, the priest on the other side of the confessional screen, said, "Well, if you've been stealing that much, you need to do some special penance. Have you ever done a retreat?" And he said to the father through the screen, "Well, Father, no, I've never done a retreat, but if you'll get the plans, I know where to get the lumber." That's not exactly penance, is it? It's not exactly saying and meaning, "I am sorry." So the first thing we need to learn from this passage of Scripture is that we need to admit that we're sorry. Frankly, we need to admit that we're lost. That we're lost. Without Jesus, we're lost. The Pharisees, for instance, could not bring themselves to admit that they were sorry, that they needed saving, that they were lost. But we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We've all done something wrong. And it only takes doing one thing wrong to mess up a perfect record. For instance, let me tell you about the young American who went to a pub in Scotland. He went to this pub in Scotland, and as he was sitting there, this older gentleman came over and sat down and introduced himself and said, "My name is McNulty. You see the wall outside the pub? I built it with my own two hands. Stone upon stone, I built walls all over the village, just like it. But do they call me McNulty the Wall Builder? No. You see the house on the hill yonder through the window? I built it for one of my lads. I built another home, stone upon stone for my other lad. I've built houses just like those houses for many people in this village. Stone upon stone, but do they call me McNulty the House Builder? No, but you rob one bank." You know, you can do all the good in the world, but you rob one bank. You're known as McNulty the bank robber. What are you known as? We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Hank Williams, way back in 1948, wrote a familiar gospel song that I used to sing out of the Methodist Cokesbury hymnal for many a year. He wrote the famous gospel song, "I Saw the Light. I Saw the Light. I wandered so aimless, life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light." You know how it goes. But if you know anything about Hank Williams, you know how much he abused alcohol and you know how much he abused drugs. As a matter of fact, it wasn't long after he wrote the song and it became a hit that he was the headliner at a concert. Minnie Pearl, remember Minnie Pearl with the hats with the price tag hanging down? Hank Williams was so drunk and so overdosed in dealing with drugs that he wasn't able to perform. And so Minnie Pearl and Hank Williams' manager drove him around the countryside trying to sober him up as he was in the back seat of the car. And Minnie Pearl and his manager kept singing, "I saw the light. I saw the light. I wandered so aimless, life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in." And Hank Williams said to Minnie Pearl, "Minnie, I don't see the light. There ain't no light." And on the back seat of a Cadillac in West Virginia on December the 31st of 1953, Hank Williams died. Can we say we're sorry? Can we say that we found the light? That God loves each of us and will forgive us? Can we accept Jesus as Lord and Savior and be sure of that? That there's nothing that you can do to make God love you more, and there's nothing you can do to make God love you less, that He gave His only begotten Son to die for our sins. So if you want to make God happy today, if you want to make the angels of heaven rejoice, make sure that Jesus is in your heart, is your Savior, is your Lord. And if you want to make God really happy, not only by accepting Jesus into your life, you tell other people about it. The shepherd called all his friends and said, "Come, I found my lost sheep. I want you to celebrate with me." The woman who found her lost coin, she called all her friends and said, "Come celebrate with me. If you have found the Lord, if the Lord has found you, then you've got to let it show." That might be as a secret agent of sorts, you know. Some of us are not real keen on telling people about our faith. We're a little bit bashful. We don't want to bother anybody else. But we've got to let it show. And we've got to let people know through words or through actions. We've got to let people know. You've heard the story of the starfish, of the little boy. As the morning was breaking, the sun was shining down, and there were hundreds and thousands of starfish there on the seashore. And if they stayed on the seashore as the sun came up, they would die there. But the little boy was throwing them back out into the ocean, and a man walks up and says, "Young lad, how in the world can you make any difference at all with these thousands of starfish? You cannot make a difference. There are too many." And the little boy reaches down and picks up one and throws it out into the waves and said, "It made a difference for that one." Who are the people in our lives that it will take you or take me to make that difference? To let them know that they mean something to God, that God will search for them to the far corners of the earth to bring them home. I remind you of my story, my personal story. I've shared it before, but I need to share it again. It begins in 1855. It began really before that, but there was a Sunday school teacher whose name was Edward Kimball, who went to a shoe store on a street in Boston, Massachusetts, between Paul Revere's house and the north end of Boston. There's a plaque there today. And he shared the good news of Jesus Christ and forgiveness to a 15-year-old young man who was selling shoes, who gave his life to Jesus. His name was Dwight L. Moody. And Dwight L. Moody went on to preach the gospel. Now, one lady said to him one time, "I don't like the way you present the gospel." And Dwight L. Moody said to her, "I don't like the way I do it either. Tell me how you do it." And she said, "I don't." And he said, "Well, I like the way I do it as opposed to the way you don't do it." And so Dwight L. Moody shared the gospel, even went to England, shared the gospel with the Queen, Queen Victoria at the time. And then he shared it with others, and a man by the name of Frederick B. Meyer was saved. Once was lost, but became found. Frederick B. Meyer preached the gospel, even came to the United States and preached the gospel. A man by the name of Wilbur M. Chapman became a Christian. He started sharing the gospel, the good news that Jesus loves each one of us. And there was a baseball player by the name of Billy Sunday who needed to hear about Jesus and God's grace and God's forgiveness. And Billy Sunday started sharing God's grace and God's goodness. And a fellow by the name of Mordecai Ham became a Christian. And then he was invited to Charlotte, North Carolina to a dairy barn. In 1934, and a young 15-year-old lad by the name of Billy Graham became a Christian. And a lot of you have been to the Billy Graham Library, and you've seen Ruth Graham's grave, and you've seen Billy Graham's grave. And it's no small wonder, it's not an accident that is shaped like a dairy barn, because it was in that dairy barn that Billy Graham felt that Jesus loved him. And he became a Christian. And though I had been confirmed in the church, had made my head profession of faith, it was in March of 1971, listening to a Billy Graham crusade on television, that it came to my heart, and I believed in Jesus. Now, here's the question. As I think about us sharing the good news, because it's happened to us, if any one of those persons that I listed had broken the chain anywhere along the way, would I be here today? I've got a lot of family, and I've got a lot of friends and cousins who are pretty sure I wouldn't be. The Great Commission, Matthew 28, go therefore into all the world, preach the gospel, has become the great omission. Louis Grizzard, who used to talk about how much he loved Moreland United Methodist Church, said before his death that he was thinking about becoming what he called a Jehovah's bystander. He said, they asked me to be a witness, but I'm only a fanatic for the Georgia Bulldogs. Well, in many ways, we've all become bystanders rather than really doing anything to help anybody else. The story of the young preacher in the mountains comes to mind. The young preacher said to this mountain man, are you a Christian? And the man said, no, but I believe they live a couple miles down the road. And the preacher said, no. What I mean is, are you lost? He said, why, no, I'm not lost. I've lived here for about 70 years. And then the young preacher said, well, really what I want to know is, are you ready for the judgment day? And the man said, when is it? And the young preacher said, I don't know. It could be today or tomorrow. And the old man said, well, you come back when you find out. My wife will probably want to go both days. Have mercy. St. John's was dedicated. This church building was dedicated on September the 20th, 1964. And of the original building committee, only Jewel Daly is still alive. But this church tore down its old historic church building just to make room for all those new folks who came with the Savannah River plant site now to come and change Aiken forever. Thank God for the Jewel Dalys and the people of this church who said, we welcome you. We welcome you. Willing to tear down their old church just to make room for new people. Oh, if we would make new people and look out for those people who don't know Jesus. Marco Polo and his dad and uncle went to see Kublai Khan in China on the Silk Road in 1260 A.D. And Kublai Khan asked for them to go back to Italy and asked the Pope that he might send 100 missionaries. And they got back to Italy, and the Pope sent 2. And both of those, before they got to Turkey, turned around and went back to Italy. Now I want you to think, what if those 100 priests had gone? What would the world be like today if China had become Christian? Think about that. What would your neighborhood be like if you shared the gospel? First, that you're saved, and that everybody needs it. That Jesus really is the answer. Let me close with this little story. There was a young woman named Kathy who had a dog named Patches. And the veterinarian decided that what Patches needed to get well was a tablespoon of castor oil every day. Now she would wrestle Patches and Patches would fight against it. She just knew he hated that castor oil. And one day, Patches kicked over the bottle of castor oil. It spilled everywhere. Got loose from Kathy's arms. And you know what Patches started doing? Licking up the castor oil. The castor oil was never the problem. It was being pinned down that was the problem. Now, I'm going to pin you down. Do you know that you're a Christian? Does God's Spirit bear witness with your spirit that you are a child of God? And if you do know that you are one, then you need to let other people know about it. That's what the woman did. That's what the shepherd did. That's what God does. He seeks the lost. How do you answer? In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.